So meet the Magnificent Four: Zoe Nathanson, who plays Danny; Sarah Sugarman, who plays Tony; Kathy Murphy, Tubbed; and Liz Campion, Jailbird. Zoe, how old were you when you made this? You look about four.
I'm 14. I made it when I was 14. Actually, I had my birthday on set, and they gave me a gold chain, which is really nice.
Fantastic. How did they find you for the film?
I was at Annashur Drama School, and Philip came along, looking like he always does.
What, do you mean distinguished, elegant, rich?
And he said to me, could somebody volunteer to do something for me? So I stuck up my hand, and he said, would you cry for me and have a nervous breakdown? So I did. And then I went to lots of...
You cried or had a nervous breakdown?
I had both.
Really? How did you make yourself cry and have a nervous breakdown?
No, actually, I brought back bad memories, I suppose.
What was the toughest thing in the film? What was the hardest bit to do?
Well, actually, it was about 11 o'clock at night, and Philip and Chris decided to make me run around the pitch in the size 10 football boots with... at about 11 o'clock at night.
When you're broken into the ground to sleep there and get the tickets.
Right, yeah. And I was running about and about, and they made me do it again and again and again. And in the end, I just couldn't do it anymore.
I think the toughest from an acting point of view, it seems to me, must have been the bath, when you had to pretend that the whole team was in there with you and they weren't.
Well, in fact, I really didn't want to do that scene, and Philip persuaded me to do it. Because he's a very persuasive
what
person.
A bully. What
I just looked
about?
Into his beautiful eyes.
And you're going to do lots more stuff.
Hopefully.
Have you had any offers yet?
I have, actually. I'm John Binkley, who's an American producer. He wants me to do a series with him, but I'm not sure whether I've got the part yet, but hopefully I will have.
What's it about?
It's called No Adults Allowed, and it's girls and kids of my age playing older people, like adults, and the part I want is an erotic mother, so I won't find it hard.
Erotic or neurotic?
Neurotic.
Very interesting. Just as well. Sarah, Zoe had the least interest in football when she made this, but you had a bit of interest in sport, didn't you?
No.
Oh,
I did as a child. When I was... I used to play a lot of football.
Did you?
Yes.
Play it for a team?
Yes.
Were you any good?
No. They kicked me out in the end. I thought I was.
How did you get your part? Because you come from Rhyl in the north of England, which is not necessarily the headquarters of the acting...
The film world. Well, I just Philip asked me if I could play football, and I lied to him. That's why.
Was it enjoyable as it looked? I mean, did you all get on extremely well?
Oh, we got on great.
She'll say anything at all. Kathy, it's a lie, isn't it? You had terrible rows.
No, we didn't. We all got on really well, but we're all such different people. I mean, I don't know. Like, you're kind of like woman's lib. I'm just ordinary, and Zara's eccentric, and we're all just so different people, but we all got on well, didn't we?
How did you find it at all tricky to capture the period? I mean, it's something you've read about.
Not with the beehive, no. They gave me a beehive. My hair's quite thick, though, so it fell out. But when we first started it, gave me this great big beehive. It made me look like Mari Wilson. So I sort of felt the period then. I felt into the 60s.
Liz, women's lib, and are they spreading vicious lies, or is this true?
Well, I don't know what you have to say to that. I'm not libelling me on the television.
You were at Leicester University. No, you weren't. You were at Warwick University.
Warwick, yes,
close, in the Midlands anyway.
Yes.
So how did you come to acting from that?
Well, when I decided to leave university, I didn't know quite what I wanted to do, but I definitely didn't want to go into teaching at that point, because going into a staff room was a bit depressing, really. Everyone owned things which were theirs, like their seats and their cups, and teaching practice is a bit depressing, really. But so I decided I wanted to do something else, something to be a bit youthful for a bit longer.
Philip Saville, who directed the film, is it true what Zoe says, that you gave her a very bad time?
Well, I did, actually, yeah, I must admit. I had to find somebody that I could really...
kick about.
To sustain something over a long period of time. And 4 weeks for an actress every day is a long time. And I wanted to be certain that you could get all the areas. To be funny is one thing, but to be moving is another.
It's a remarkable performance, isn't it?
Yes, it is. I was incredibly happy that I found you to do it. I was very happy that I found all of them. I think all the four of them were tremendous.
What was hardest to pull off from behind the camera?
Well, I think about, was it 32 locations in sort of 4 week shooting?
Was it literally 32?
Well, 31, give or take. 32, yeah. Sometimes three or four a day. It was quite, it can be done. You have to have it very well planned, and you have to have a very sustained group of people. And of course, I had wonderful people playing the other parts, like Julie McKenzie, Peter Tilbury.
We haven't said enough about that. Yes. I mean, they're all excellent.
They were tremendous. In fact, their story is another film on its own, really, which could have...
The parents' story, maybe.
Yes. Because it's ironical that the girl can watch her parents disintegrate and not take any notice because of her own preoccupations. I mean...
And vice versa, of course.
Yes, of course. Yes.
Let me talk to Chris Griffin, who produced the picture. Chris, why is it such a telescope shooting schedule?
Telescope shooting? Well, all the First Love series have been a very sort of condensed shooting period. It seemed to work very well, actually, but that added sort of stress factor, and certainly Philip did wonders under that sort of pressure, as indeed all the other directors did.
Do you think they work entirely successfully in both on the small screen and the large, or do you think we're breeding something of a hybrid?
I would like to think that they work as well on the big screen. I mean, going back to one of the other First Loves, Experience Preferred But Not Essential, which we made last July, July of last year, not this year, that's just opened in New York and is doing amazing business. The Americans seem to love it.
Derek Malcolm, film critic of The Guardian. What did you make of it?
I liked it very much. I think it's a very enjoyable little film. I wish it could go out into the cinemas.
Did you find it more of a television movie than a film movie?
No, I thought it was made precisely the same way as it would be made if it were made for the cinema, like a lot of the Channel 4 productions I've seen. That's a great advantage of them. They actually look better on a big screen than on a small.
It's really a series of set pieces, in a sense. Very enjoyable ones, I've found, like the suicide, the pretend suicide at least, and the initiation ceremony on the pitch, and when she breaks into the ground and spends the night there. Which of those do you like best?
Well, I don't think that I have a favourite scene. I just think that the handling of the children was very good. I think the children played extremely well throughout the movie. But you can't do that unless you have a good director, because children can look quite false on the screen if you don't handle them well. And I think the director really needs complimenting for really handling them terribly well throughout. Only one thing I didn't like about the movie, and that was the music. I thought that was wet and made the movie a little less sharp and a little less hard than it might otherwise have been. But otherwise, I give full marks. I think it's a great film.
What about the performances of the adults?
Oh, they were excellent too. I think that all the performances were good, but once again, very well observed, and I congratulate a fellow journalist in such a good script. Not many journalists make very good film scripts, but she certainly has.
Talking of a fellow journalist, do you think it was an accurate picture of the gentleman of the press?
Yes, pretty accurate. I saw our own film correspondent there. He looked pretty accurate to me. Yes, I think it was.
Just to go back to the performances, did you love Elizabeth Spriggs as much as I did? That marvellous long speech she has when she boasts of training a member of the Trinidad and Tobago Olympic team.
Yes, excellent. I think she was marvellous. I'd liked a little bit more of her, but you can't... Or I suppose it's really better to have very short bursts of that sort of character playing, but I thought she was perhaps the best thing in the film for me, apart from the children.
Derek, let's bring in David Putnam, executive producer of the film. David, the only real criticism there was the music. Did you dislike it?
The problem with working to the sort of schedule we're forced to is that, unfortunately, it's always a tremendous afterthought, whereas with a feature film, you can normally have the composer working with you as you're making the picture. Trevor Jones did a wonderful job, and he came in, I think, literally 3 weeks before we finished the picture. And you always, I think, get the sense, and I feel it often with television, that the music's been stuck on, because in truth it has been.
Will this get cinema release?
Yes, it will. It'll go out as a double bill in the spring. Rank have already seen it and like it a lot.
Because you're a raving Spurs fan yourself, aren't you?
Traitor, yes.
How did it come to be then? You had a hand in the hatching of it, didn't you?
Yes, I really was questioning Chasing Julie. I've always liked the way she wrote. She writes in a very filmic manner. I mean, her reporting is basically filmic. And so I was nudging her. And then one day we were talking and she came up with exactly this story. And it seemed to me if I really worked hard for a year, I might meet Danny Blanchard.
To say nothing of Derek Malcolm.
To say nothing of Derek Malcolm.
And since it's partly at least a football movie, we'll leave you with an action replay of some of tonight's highlights. From me, good night.